good evening to all. I would like to speak on women in school leadership from the book that I have published in 2019 recently. So I will go to my PowerPoint presentations and share the details. Okay. Yeah, next. The women in school leadership, the topic of the talk today, why school women's leadership is important in school education. It has a positive impact on enrollment and participation of girls in the schools. Mothers talk easily about their children with women teachers and principals. Becoming a teacher is a powerful means to participate and establish identity within the communities in Afghanistan, Pakistan, and such other countries. That's how the UNESCO studies have shown some of these findings. And moreover, women leaders adopt democratic and participatory leadership styles, prefer relationship building and consensus for decision making, willing to work together and practice role modeling, future oriented and less directive and autocratic, inclined to transformational leadership styles, promote pedagogy and assist in the growth of their staff in the schools. So these are some of the positive leadership aspects that women show, and the studies show across the globe with respect to the women positive aspects of women leadership. The next one. Next slide. Yeah. What are the challenges of women's participation in the schools? See, some of the challenges, especially in the traditional societies, and which mostly has the developing countries, are covert compulsions to assume male persona to function as a school leader, and coveted opportunities. See, in the coveted opportunities, it can range from getting on to the studies in education, leadership, to complete the degree. Those are also constraints for the girl students who pass out their 12th standard or so in some of the countries. Then the patriarchy, drawing a parallel between home and school. See, if a woman wants to become a teacher, the family sees what type of a school is it. Is it home-like school? So that home-like is one of the criteria for their daughters to join the school as teachers. Choosing a teaching profession due to respectability is weakening due to role conflicts in India and Sri Lanka. However, there is also a recognition that teaching profession is losing its respectability due to role conflicts in India and Sri Lanka. Okay, next. So, within these given constraints and within this very short, a brief introduction to the impediments and the challenges that women face to become leaders. Yeah, after becoming leaders, what really they how really they navigate through to become successful is something that was explored through a qualitative research study conducted in Indian context. So that the narrative analysis showed that the pattern that emerges is that there is a ladder of success, starting from to aspire and acquire the leadership position, aspire for leadership position, then acquire the leadership position, then achieve that leadership position, having working in the school for a while, then ascend as a leader, and then transcend as a leader. What do they actually mean? aspire is about, to aspire for leadership is not only by the daughter or the only by that woman, but it is a collective aspiration of the significant others in the family, namely the parents and the husband mostly. Then it is about the intellectual capital in the family, the parental background, parental educational background, as well as the in-laws, house, when they are married into and go to the other family, become the members of the other family in the husband's house. Even that intellectual capital, in terms of the educational qualification, then their job, their status also matters. Then the vocational anticipatory socialization is another factor, especially when the child is growing up, when the girl child is growing up, how they get influenced by the parents' aspirations and their preparations, so on and so forth. And also if their mothers are employed, that also has significantly influenced. Seeing them growing with the parents who are employed, growing with the parents who are aspirational though not employed, has really built in this vocational and anticipatory socialization. Then the next step in the ladder is to acquire. And this acquiring the leadership position comes from, working in the system for a while and then competing in the examinations or getting the leadership position as school heads through the promotions. Then what do they do? How do they do this? They negotiate with the responsibilities between family and the school, and they make their choices whether to become a leader or not, to acquire that leadership position or not. Then comply with the obligations and compulsions of the family and the job. This is very important, and they see it as a necessity to comply with the obligations and compulsions, and then look for the opportunities while complying with the obligations and compulsions. They look for opportunities, they search for opportunities, and then they try to get those opportunities for themselves. Then achieve. How do they achieve? After having gone into the leadership position, having taken it up, they have to really establish themselves as leaders during those initial years of working as a school head. They actually do a lot of, they actually undergo a lot of negotiation and navigation processes. And what is captured here is, in a nutshell, they politicize the complexities, saying that all is well, and refuse to heed to the tension, saying that there is no problem at all, and construct a safety net of shadow neutrality around oneself, and yet problematize whenever negotiations are possible. A subtle tension therefore prevails beneath all these so-called, yes, all is well and there is no problem and I'm doing well. And this is a phase where there are the power relations operating, and trying to establish that status for herself as a school leader, and trying to work with all the teachers, the community, and the parents in particular. And the next step in the ladder, the ascend, actually is about, after having gained the position, worked for a while in the school system as a leader, occupying the position of the leadership as a school head, how do they evolve themselves is shown in this step four. Here, having got the confidence of working well, having gained that knowledge of how a leadership role actually to be executed, and what I must do to work better and prove myself as a leader, the ascend, the fourth step in the ladder, comes as ascend. That is the time when they try to assert, and saying that they do not encourage the patriarchal practices in the school or back at home too, and do not succumb to the status quo. Assert merit over gender-based choices. Excel as a professional. Address covert and overt gendered practices within the school and even within homes. And raise the bar of excellence. They themselves raise the bar of excellence. Set their revise their standards. Revisit their standards. Emphasize on self-effort to achieve achieve the results. And this is the step four. And having achieved this step four of increased confidence, and negotiations and navigations are much lesser to, you know, take off that level of, you know, emotionally, psychologically, intellectually stronger, they try to transcend. And here comes the attitude of service in the work that they do. And they consider the children's education as a cause of life. And cross over the norm-based leadership, practice transformational leadership, use school structure as an important means to strengthen agency, cross over the boundaries of the education system. So this is the ladder of success that the women go through. Next. Yeah, then if this is the ladder of success that they go through, well, that quest for success begins with the available opportunity in the leadership positions in the education system. They depend on recruitment policies and selection procedures in different states, distribution of school categories, schooling pattern, and school leadership positions, which are interdependent, and parallel leadership positions such as alternate choices in the education system also are significantly influencing capabilities of aspiring women teachers to take up the leadership roles also influence. Yeah, next. Next, yeah. So what is the status of the women in school leadership positions in India? A secondary data analysis of all states and union territories of India was analyzed. And this shows that there are particularly four school leadership positions. One is as the acting HM. Another is the head teachers. The third is the vice principals. Four is the principals. Vice principals and principals cater to the senior secondary schools. Head teachers cater to the secondary schools. Acting HMs are mostly to elementary schools, but there is no HM appointed for the designated positions. So we find that as vice principals, women are higher represented in higher secondary schools, which has primary, upper primary, secondary, and higher secondary levels in it. And in this school category, even the women teachers are more. And these women teachers are more even in elementary schools, which is about 50.5%, and even in secondary schools, starting from primary schools, which is about 54.0%. So by and large, we see that while the women teachers are larger in three of the seven categories of schools, but women as leaders, when they ascend to those leadership positions, they are seen higher as vice principals in primary to senior secondary school levels. So this is the Indian scenario. However, there is a trend of increased participation of the women as teachers in this profession, but as leaders, there is still a need to ascend, and we need to see their participation more and more. Yeah, next. Next. Yes. So then the qualitative data was further analyzed to find out what are those determinants of school leadership for women. Here, while doing so, the interaction between structure and agency was studied in depth through a fine-grained analysis of the narratives that were prepared by collecting the data, in which the agency was studied in the form of through the lens of projective and practical evaluative agency, and the structures were discerned to be the family, the school, also considered a kind of a structure. So the interaction between the structure and agency was consciously studied. Why? Because we see that most of the studies either deal exclusively with the agency of the women, or exclusively with how structures influence. But when it comes to looking, and then there is a structure agency interaction. But now we were trying to see that how this interaction really happens. I was trying to see that in this book. And so they were looked for in this fine-grained analysis, explicit and implicit cues observed or demonstrated by the women leaders, and loosely coupled options available as choices to be exercised. And these were the criteria that were taken to analyze. And what emerged was the three determinants, that is, they determinants of school leadership of women are they practice people-centered approach, and show restrained neutrality. It is not total neutrality when they are when they are working as leaders, but a restrained neutrality. And then building trust is another important determinant to become a successful school leader as a woman. So so having
Dr. Maithili,
yeah,
you have 2 more minutes.
Yeah, having identified the determinants, one step more was taken up. What is it? See, to become the women leader is one, to succeed as a women leader is one, but the legitimacy of the to be established as a women leader is also another aspect. Here, the leadership behaviors were particularly studied in depth vis-a-vis their gender perspective. The gender perspectives were drawn from the theoretical underpinnings of Max Weber's, where the rational and rational leadership style and traditional leadership. One more step, please backwards. Yeah, juxtaposed with promotion focused leadership behavior and preventive focused leadership behavior. Here we see that aspects that were taken, the factors considered to study were the status, the perception of the power differentials, negotiations held, acceptance of the leadership, and therefore the legitimacy. The perception of the status, if it is higher, power differentials are lower, the negotiation is least, therefore the acceptance is very high, legitimacy is voluntary and therefore higher, that we normally see in the level of the transcend in the ladder that we saw our and the ascent. The status is higher, but the power difference. Is also moderate and it is mediated. This is seen in the level of achieve, the third step in the ladder. And if the status is lower, power differentials are also lower, negotiations are unfavorable, then it is the level of either not becoming a leader as yet or just having entered as a school head through promotion or through direct recruitment. Then next please. It is in the same way the other also. Then how do we define the school leadership? Having studied these aspects and their negotiations and navigate through the negotiations and navigations, it is not all that easy that we know of, because these women have come from their middle class or lower middle class backgrounds, which is unlike the corporate leadership, or that we are talking of the very lower strata of the society where women, poverty, and the caste, other aspects have influenced a lot. These women are somewhere in the middle, and how do they navigate it was something that we try to capture, that I try to capture. Therefore, defining a school leadership of women in Indian context was defined using a method of contradiction, that I would call it as a method of contradiction, having not only but also. And what is that not only but also? The school leadership of women is not only about doing leadership, but also about knowledge which propels the very doing. It is not only about achieving the under favorable conditions, but also accomplishing in spite of. It is not only about the will to do, but the willingness to give up. It is not only the ownership, but the readiness to let go. It is not only about problematizing a situation, but looking afresh at situations with a hope in the future. It is not only about recognition, reward, or merit, but accepting the limitations, under recognition, misrecognition, non-recognition, or an extra recognition at times. Then it is not only about the vertical growth of creating followers as a leader, but an horizontal expansion working amidst people. It is not only about exercising the power, but understanding the power of the power. It is not only celebrating the success, but smiling at the failures. It is not only about getting the encouragement, but developing a dispassion about denial of opportunities. The last slide I would like to end with. So what is gender in school leadership in Indian context mean? It is about acting independently, yet exercising restraint neutrality. There is a peculiar admix of binaries in leading schools by women in India. That is, exercise caution over fearlessness, practicing masculinity and femininity together, silently resist covert compulsions arising from patriarchy, yet verbalize it occasionally, use intuition over logic, make no distinction between personal and professional life at times when it is called for. Then, thank you so much. This is my brief presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Mitri. It's wonderful. Okay, we will we are holding on to questions, and we will take after Professor Nitya Rao has presented. Professor Nitya Rao, can we request you to please take? I think a request for 2 minutes to each of the panelists. Professor Mathili first, because she has not yet spoken. Mathili.
Thank you.
Would you like to say something?
Yeah. We refer to women who are there in the lower rung of the society, striving hard. Those women get the attention, maybe the farmers, maybe the Anganwadi workers, or maybe the laborers, etc. And on the other side, we have women who have excelled in the corporate sectors, and as leaders, and have led and brought high profits for the company, and as well as become visible. Now, the education is one sector in which women are, which kind of women enter. They are the women who are educated, who have a family background which is, educated. Maybe the parents are also in the formal sectors of employment. When it comes to their leadership in the schools, that is very less talked about. So Kirk, why in one place she asks, while women in development and gender and development speak about these two and draw examples of leadership, where are the teachers in this weed and gat? And that is something that comes to me quite often, because when we are talking about leadership, we assume that the educated, employed women in the public systems like education or the health or other social security networks, we really do not look at them. And here is one place where the women's struggles and the voices are unheard, despite working hard and despite leading from the front also. So in India especially, we have not made a dent in the area of leadership of school heads. One of the preliminary, the most one of those first works I happened to lay work on unconsciously, since I thought that it is an interesting area, but it was found that this was one work which got exclusive attention on women as leaders. Earlier it used to be like women as a category was conceived, women leaders, that is the principals or HMs, were included, submerged under the category of teachers. There was no distinction between the teachers and the women who led the schools or who are education officers. So one of those critical important areas that we need to take up in our country as a discourse to begin on women leadership is in the area of educational leadership. we do not have. So even in terms of policy, when Govind Kelkar madam was trying to address this question of policy, our recruitment policies are gender neutral. In terms of recruitment policies in most of the states, they are gender neutral. So it comes on seniority basis or it comes through direct recruitment. If there is a merit, yes, you get in. But after having got in through the merit and through the direct recruitment competitions and all, how do these women perform? Where are they? How are they negotiating and navigating with a system which has got its own beliefs and values that are drawn from the larger society, which is mostly patriarchal? So this becomes very important when we are addressing some of the important areas of learning deficit in the country. While the women teachers are seen as very good, very appropriate to teach in the classrooms, why women are not seen as that good and appropriate to lead the schools, to lead the education systems, is something to be tapped. That's the policy intervention that we need to take also.
Thank you so much, Professor Mathili. I need to apologize. I have to now go for vaccine to take. And in 10 minutes, I have the appointment, so which will take going to the center where I have the appointment. So Professor Nityananda has very kindly agreed to chair the session. I am sorry that I am missing this very important kind of discussion, but I'll connect with you later. So please excuse me and continue. I hand over the chairpersonship to Professor Nityanand. Professor Nityanand, yeah. Please.
Thank you, Professor Govind Kelkar, and hope for the best for you for your vaccination.
Thank you.
Hope you don't get any
reaction. I'll let you know. Thank you.
Okay, so continuing with the discussion, if anybody would have some further questions, comments.
Yes, sir. Can I make a small comment over now?
Okay, yes.
Yeah. I agree with Professor Nitya Rao that along with the legal reformation, there has to be a policy support system, no doubt about that one. But also we should make sure that the policy support system is also something which is going to bring about a real development in the lives of women, rather than trying to reinforce the patriarchal nature as far as the jobs is concerned. Like as we see in many of the self-development group, how the certain gender-based rules are something again reinformed, whatever the kind of a nature of job. To quote also, I'll try to show that only in MSME sector, only you have around 13.6% of the women entrepreneurs over there. So that is also quite shocking. We need to increase the policy intervention, should be more inclusive in trying to expand the scope as far as the women is concerned. Even in the corporate leadership with Professor Maitri was talking about, we have around only 11% of them in as far as the leadership position is concerned. That is also something which needs to be. So the policy reforms, policy support system also has to be oriented in such a manner that slowly we have to shed the patriarchal notions and value system associated with that one. So along with that, the legal reforms are going to bring about a lot of transformation, help women to really exhibit more of the leadership skills is concerned. That's my point. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
If I may just, Professor Nityanand, I think...
Would like to have any comments?
Yeah, I'll just make a concluding comment. Mainly, I don't have anything much to add. I just wanted to thank you and thank CST for the opportunity for having this discussion today on International Women's Day. I think in India, we have seen a lot of progress, a lot of legal progress as well, especially in the 2000s, in the decade of the 2000s, there was a lot of legislation on violence. I think the Justice Verma Commission. And I think what we need to be really careful, and we need to, International Women's Day is about mobilization, about organization, about celebration. And my request to everybody is that we have to again get together to actually fight and struggle against the setbacks or the move backwards that we are seeing over the last couple of years, whether it is in terms of honor killings, whether it is in terms of violence, whether it is in terms of withdrawal of support to women, also to poor men. I would include in this that it is not only women, but when we are moving towards gender equality is what we want. We want equal opportunities in all ways. And I think that some of the pushback that is coming in India against women's rights, I think this is something we need to be really vigilant about, so that, I know that there are many more battles to be won. And I think the women's movement for the last 50 years has been fighting, has been building bridges, has been building networks with other movements. And I think even small victories. I started my career in SEWA, which is Self-Employed Women's Association, which is a trade union of women workers. And one of our mottos was that we should celebrate even small victories, because it is so difficult for women to get equality or victories. We have come a long way since then, but this time, I think, is really, people pointed out, Vidyut Ji pointed out to the farmers on the Singur border, the Supreme Court judgment, or the Supreme Court said that women farmers can go home, they're not farmers. I think these kind of statements is where we have to be very vigilant and very careful in order to immediately be aware of what is going on and to fight against it. I think we have to know how to choose our battles. And for me, the first battles are really that to hold on to the gains we have already made and then push forward. So with this, I would like to close and wish you all a very happy International Women's Day in solidarity.
Okay, thank you. I guess we do not have any further comments and questions. I hope you all agree that we had a very interesting discussion. We started with, how patriarchy works in our society, in our family, and how that kind of acts as constraint for women coming out, participating in workforce, and eventually taking up the leadership role. We also have seen, discussed that there have been situations where women are coming out in large numbers in a particular fields where women are a large number, but when it comes to leadership role, they are not chosen over men. Suddenly, men are considered to be the more appropriate for leading even in the spheres where women are in large numbers. Now, this is also linked to what was coming from patriarchy, and not just patriarchy, but in a society where equality of opportunity is by and large absent. It's not just about women, but if you think about other marginalized section of population, be it Dalits, be it tribals, you will see a similar thing happening. They might come at up to certain level, but then beyond that becomes difficult. But we have also discussed women taking up leadership role in rural economy, in food security, and how they are providing literacy in a very difficult situation. So the crux, I think, is that the major challenge is that equality of opportunity, which has also been highlighted by the speakers, that whether it's women, whether it's Dalit, whether it's minorities, whether it's tribals, and people coming from poor background in general, who are not empowered to be, from their birth, always find it difficult to go up, so because our society is very feudal also. Now, unless we get into that, unless we ensure equal opportunity, unless we give equal education in terms of quality also to all, it's difficult to get out of all those things. So challenge is very huge. We have seen some progress, but of course, that is not good enough, and hopefully we all would be with our fight, we all would be able to bring a better situation in coming days. I would now request Purnima to formally give vote of thanks to our honorable speakers and other participants. Purnima, please.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much, everyone. On behalf of CSD, I extend my deep sense of gratitude to Professor Nityananda for his welcome note and for setting the tone for the discussion, and also for being kind to conclude the session as well. And I'm extremely thankful to Professor Govind Khelkar for agreeing to chair the session and for the wonderful job done. And my special thanks are due to the three speakers, Professor Nitya Rao, Dr. Maitri, and Dr. Venkat, for their perspectives, the examples given on successful women leaders in food security, and for raising our concerns on critical issues that has to be addressed. And I also express my gratitude to my good colleagues at CST and the fellow participants of this event. Thanking you all. Yeah.
Thank you, Purnima, for giving the opportunity. Thank you, CSD, for giving the opportunity. Ma'am, Nitya ma'am, got to see you on the panel, and I thank you so much. It was a wonderful listening to you, and as well as Venkat Narayan. Good to get in touch.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, CSD, and thank you, Director Purnima, everyone, and the speakers, Maitri ma'am, and Nitya ma'am, everyone. It's really, really a very good initiative, and hope we continue this dialogue for a long period.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Purnima, for organizing and getting in touch.
You all.
Thank you.